is really fab. It's been great doing the work that we have done together. So it's great. Thanks, Steve. So yeah, I'm going to talk to you today briefly. I think we've got 20 minutes. So I'll just check the time. Yeah, to talk to you about effective assessment in science and maths. And I should be honest here and say that I'm actually, my background is as a secondary English teacher. So I was a secondary English teacher. I then worked 4 years as head of assessment at ARC Schools, another multi-academy trust. And then currently, as I say, work for No More Marketing as director of education. So you might think, what have we got to learn, what have we got to learn from this? But hopefully there'll be some bits here about science and maths that you'll find useful. So what I want to start with actually is a bit of a distinction between different types of assessment tasks. And this is something that when I first came across this distinction really made things clear for me in a way that hadn't happened before. I came across it, I'll show you the reference, the academic reference in a moment. And actually one of the ways it made things clear for me in assessment was it helped me see the differences between the types of tasks that are typically done in maths and science and the types that are typically done in, say, English and history. So you might be thinking, well, what's all this about? I've got a picture of somebody doing the high jump and a picture of somebody doing some ice dancing. And I haven't picked those at random. These are two analogies for types of assessment that are used in this academic paper that I found really enlightening, really helpful. And they say there's these two models of assessment, the quality model and the difficulty model. And the difficulty model is like the high jump, in that you're asking children to do ever more difficult tasks. And the quality model is like ice dancing, in that you ask someone to perform and then you judge their performance. So I'll just talk you through those two models. We've got the quality model here. This is can be compared to ice dancing. You basically ask students to do something and then you judge how well they do it. And you refer to a set of descriptors often to judge how well the pupils have done it. And the analogy is, it's competitive ice dancing. That's a pure quality model. The skater is expected to go out and perform in a way that impresses the judges as much as possible. So you'll see, I'm sure it's got the quote, the citation at the bottom. It's by two academics called Aisha Ahmed and Alistair Pollitt, and this is their analogy. So one type of assessment that we might do with our pupils is we say to them, go out and perform. And so when you ask pupils to write an essay, to speak in a foreign language, to design something, perhaps in design and technology, that's a quality model of assessment. The difficulty model, by contrast, very different. And the usual approach here is you give pupils a series of tasks that vary in difficulty. So you give them one task, if they get that right, you give them a harder one, if they get that right, you give them a harder one, and then you can add up how well they've done on all of those and add them together and come up with a number. And we call that the difficulty model of measurement because central to it is you're mapping students' ability to the different difficulties of the tasks. And the analogy is with the high jump. That's a clear example of the difficulty model. It's a series of tasks of increasing difficulty which continue until everybody's failed. Sounds quite negative, but there you go. And those quotations are taken from that paper that was referred to on the previous page. And I hope you'll see immediately from this that in maths and science, typically, not invariably, but typically, the type of assessment task you're using is that difficulty model. That often the assessments we use with pupils consist of lots of questions that increase in difficulty. So GCSE maths and science exams have a lot in common with this approach. And in terms of the technical challenges of setting tasks with these two models, they have different technical challenges. And I say this is what was quite enlightening for me when I was thinking of working across a whole school and thinking, or a whole group of schools, and thinking of an assessment policy that would work across them. It was trying to think of something that would work across both of these types of models. So this is also from the same paper. They say, what are the technical challenges? The technical challenges with the quality model is all about the reliability of the marking. So the great difficulty, if you ask a child to write an essay or to speak in a foreign language or to design something, the great difficulty is not in setting the task, it's how do you judge the standard they're at. The quality model, by the other hand, the great difficulty is in the selection of the questions that make up the paper. That's the difficulty. So with the quality model, all of your difficult decisions and work come after the assessment. The the kids do the assessment and you've got a job on your hands to say, how do I judge these assessments? With the difficulty model, all of the problems and difficulties come beforehand in deciding what questions should I include in the exam paper? What types of questions, where do I get them from? How do I know they're difficult enough? So you've got different technical challenges. And what's appropriate for maths and science, I've put up here some of the things. Traditionally, we would use the difficulty model for maths and science, and in many ways, that's totally fine. In many ways, you'll be able to solve a lot of the assessment issues you have for assessment using a series of tasks. And I've said there, the great advantage of it is as long as you use externally set tests, you don't have a problem with marking reliability. So you can mark the tests, you can get a reliable score, and you can relate that score to some kind of national standard. And that's amazing. And as an English teacher, there were plenty of times when I wished it was like that. Because the quality model brings in all kinds of difficulties for marking, as we'll see. What are the disadvantages? I've put up two disadvantages of this model. One disadvantage is, sometimes, because when we do an externally set test and we get a mark from it, we can think to ourselves, oh, I can just set any test I like, and the mark I get from it will be nationally standardised. That's not true. You might remember I said, what's the technical difficulty? The technical difficulty with this model is choosing the questions, designing the questions. So when you just create some yourself, you can run into some issues. I'm going to show that on the next slide. The other disadvantage is you're limited in this model to very closed questions. You're limited to questions that it's very simple to say right or wrong. And actually, I'm sure you can all think of maths and science questions that you'd like to ask, but don't have right or wrong answers, and that are more difficult to mark. And if you only use a difficulty model, you can't use any of those more creative questions. So I'm just going to explore these disadvantages a bit more. So the first one is tests you've set yourself, you know, there's some issues around them. So people who are in my session before have seen this, but what I've got here is I've got three questions, three math questions, which all address the same descriptor. They all address the same concept. Can pupils compare fractions to see which is larger? Now over to you. Let's say we give these questions to a representative group of 14-year-olds. What percentage do you think get the first question right? You tell me. Have a guess. Can shout something out.
90%.
Brilliant. Whoever said 90%, spot on. Perfect. Right, so 90% of 14-year-olds get the first question. What about the second one? Same group of 14-year-olds.
70.
Oh, we're good today. Right, very good. 75. 75%. And the final one? 30, not bad, 15. Okay. So the reason I put that up there is to show you that it is really hard to judge in advance the difficulty of a question. And it isn't just hard for teachers to do that, it's hard for examiners to do that too. And in fact, when I've spoken to examiners about this, they basically say that you cannot predict this with any level of precision. And the great problem is that tiny surface changes in the detail of a question have a big impact on how difficult children find them. So let me give you another example. You ask an 8-year-old, what's 11 plus 3? Most of them get it right. You ask them, what's 3 plus 11? Many fewer get it right. Why is that? It's the same sum. But if you ask them 11 plus 3, they go 11, 12, 13, 14. If you ask them, what's 3 plus 11, what do? They go 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and they start running out of fingers. Okay? So what you can see from this, I hope, is that small changes in the surface features of a question can have a big impact on how difficult children find them. As a result of that, it is hard for you, or indeed expert examiners, to predict how difficult a question is. And that is why when it comes to setting an exam, you can't say in advance the raw mark, the number, that will be needed to achieve a certain standard. You can only really do that if you've got some prior information about those questions, about how other groups of pupils have performed on those questions. And that's why, year to year on exams, the grade boundary shifts. It's because the examiners are trying to keep the standard consistent, even though the questions are changing. So,
One risk is you do have to be careful, just because the difficulty model looks simple and it looks like I can just, you know, have a test and I can add up the numbers and I get a mark, turning that mark into something that has a consistent standard is very tricky to do. So that's one risk and one thing to think about when you're setting assessments for maps. The other disadvantage I talked about was the disadvantage of the difficulty model is you can't ask more open questions. So what if you want to, with maths and science, ask more open, more creative questions? So what if I want to use quality model style questions? Why do people want to do this? People want to do this because they want to ask questions that are maybe more real world, that are more valid, that correspond more with the kinds of problems children face in real life. So you might want to set up a more of a project style question, more of an open-ended question. Just some examples at the moment. The problem with that is that the problem is traditionally these kinds of questions are really hard to mark reliably. So if you think maybe back to the old maths coursework questions or science coursework, when you have more complex real world problems, they can be difficult to mark reliably. So how do you get around that problem? And what do you do there? It's difficult. And the risk is, there are a number of risks. If assessment isn't reliable, it's not valid either. Because you need to have the consistency of marking in order to get insightful information about your children. So the big risk, if you introduce more complex questions, is you introduced exciting and original real-world problems, but because they're so hard to mark consistently, they don't really shed the new light into people's thinking that you want. Because you don't know if the pupil's doing well, is it because they're thinking about this problem in a really original and different way, or is there a marking error problem? So that's the great problem, not just in maths and science, in any subject, with more open tasks. How do I mark it reliably so I know that the information I'm getting can be trusted and depended on? This is a big problem, and this is the problem as an English teacher I used to wrestle with, because most of the stuff we assess in English is like this. But it applies to maths and science just as well. And there's a couple of ways of trying to get around it which are not that effective. So one way we try to get around it is come up with very specific mark schemes. And again, we've seen that happen with maths and science, with coursework. The problem then is it starts to stereotype the children's response. And again, the old maths coursework really had that problem. That you had pupils who would just write exactly what they were expected to write, and actually didn't really show that they were thinking about things in a mathematically deep way. And again, same thing happened with English as well. So that doesn't necessarily help us too. The other issue we get is, particularly with maths and science, is a lot of open tasks in maths and science tend to involve writing. And the problem with that is, are you assessing maths and science? Are you assessing literacy? Obviously, that's not such a big issue in English, because we are assessing literacy. But that's a big issue we run into as well. So, modern GCSEs do tend to include more quality model style questions, and I would say, with some of these problems, don't worry, I'm going to come to some solutions. I want to lay out the problems first of all. So take a look at that. I hope, can you all see that? That's taken from a recent GCSE paper. Can you see this question? It's Tom says ABC cannot be a straight line. Explain why Tom is correct. So this is a classic quality model question. A difficulty model question would say, is Tom correct? Yes or no? And you say yes or no and it's right or wrong. A quality model question says, Tom is correct. Explain why. So you're familiar with, yeah? We know these kinds of questions, you've seen them all the time. I hope maybe you've seen that specific one, it's from a foundation paper. Yeah? Okay, is that answer, would you give, it's a 2-mark question. Who would give, put your hands up, would you give 0, 1, or 2 marks for that question? Everyone's hand up, or if you're a maths teacher, put your hand up. Would you give 0, 1, or 2 marks for that answer? Okay, I'm seeing a mix. I'm not seeing any zeros, but I'm seeing a lot of ones and twos. So immediately, even with a simple 2-mark question, we see that ambiguity coming in already. And we start to say, does that answer deserve 2 marks? Does it deserve 1 mark? Now, I've been with maths teachers who have had real debates over this. So I've picked one that is a little bit ambiguous there, but I hope you can see it's not simple or straightforward. The maths teachers I've discussed it with have said, I want to see the sum. I want to see 146 plus 32, and I'm not going to give it the mark until then. There's other people who are saying, I need to see some keywords. I need to see some keywords about angles adding up to. Okay? What about these three? Let's look at the top one. Just look at the top one for now. Can you see the top one? Straight line angles have 180 degrees. And this one only has only 146 plus 342 equals 178. It needs two more to get the correct answer. Okay. So again, do we give that 2 marks? 1 mark, no marks. Have a look at the other two. So my purpose here, actually, I'm not going to resolve any of these questions by saying, yes, it's definitely 2 marks, yes, it's definitely one, no, they can't have any. Although I will note that these are ones that cause that kind of debate and discussion. My point is to show you that the minute you start opening up the question, you start to get big questions about what's right or wrong. The other thing you start to do is, can you see literacy starting to creep in? Can you see how the teachers underline have and put add up to? Does writing add up to show more mathematical thinking than have? You can argue it, can't you, either way. But you start to see all these issues that start to creep in when we start to open up the task. It's not straightforward. It would be lovely if it was straightforward to just introduce these things, but we have issues with marking reliability, which I hope we'll recognise. So what I want to do now is suggest to you, I don't have time, I've got a few minutes, is suggest to you that there's a couple of ways you can get around this problem. So number one, I would say, don't throw the difficulty model questions out. They may not always be as rich or as creative as you want them to be, but they're really easy to mark and they're reliable. So you can get a lot of value from them. And the other thing I'm going to suggest is when it comes to the open questions, the quality model questions, a process called comparative judgment, which is what we work with at No More Marking, we have an online comparative judgment engine, which is very good for all kinds of open questions. So I'm just going to give you a quick survey of it and then show you some examples from maths and science. So comparative judgment works like this. Our traditional way of marking open tasks is like this. We have some kind of script or task, we have some kind of descriptor, and we attempt to match that piece of work to the descriptor. Comparative judgment is very different. Comparative judgment works like this. You have two tasks, two pupil responses, and you look at both of them, and you say to yourself, which is the better piece? Which is the better task? Which is the better response? And if you make a series of judgments like that, and your colleagues make a series of judgments like that, what the comparative judgment algorithm does is to combine all of those decisions and to use them to come up with a measurement scale for every piece of work in the pot. We have used it a lot for writing, but we've used it a lot for maths as well. And when you use it for maths, you use it for open tasks. So let me give you some examples, some good questions for comparative judgment maths, ones that aren't as good. You'll see the ones that aren't so good are your typical difficulty model questions. They don't work with comparative judgment, you can just mark them normally. But you'll see on the left, these are the kind of questions that are good for comparative judgment. My favourite one is the top one. What rules do you know in maths are always true? That is a great question, I love that question. I'm going to show you, we've given this to a group of year 6 and year 7 pupils. I'm going to show you my two favourite responses. The first response is this one. I hope you can see there, we've got a pupil who, in response to what rules do you know maths are always true, has written n multiplied by 0 equals 0, and n plus 0 equals n. It took me a bit of a while to decipher what they've written, but when you do that feels like a very impressive answer. The next one, same question, different pupil, need to decipher this one too, but this is a pupil, I'll read it out for you if you need to see. What rules do you know maths are always true? Read the problem. You need to fill the whole page, which they've done. They've filled the whole page, telling us you need to fill the whole page. I think there's very little maths content in that answer, unlike this one, where I think there's some really interesting mathematical thinking. So those are two of my favourite responses to an open maths task that you can respond to in different ways. And I think you'll see with that question, it is tapping mathematical thinking in a way that is very hard to do with a difficulty model style question. Yeah, does that feel fair? But it's also, unlike the traditional method of marking such questions, we have a method of marking these that's very reliable. It doesn't fall into the problems that other methods have. For science, here are some good examples. Where does the human body get energy from? What is a chemical bond? Why are some elements more reactive than others? Another good one I've heard recently, using as much scientific knowledge as possible, explain why squirrels live in forests and not in deserts. So those are the kind of questions you can ask and mark very reliably using comparative judgment. It's a different way of thinking about maths and science. So I'll just finish off here. I said at the start, when you are assessing, you always have technical challenges. With the difficulty model, the technical challenges come before. They come when you set the question. With the quality model, the challenges come after. They come when you're doing the marking. In terms of how comparative judgment helps, with the quality model, we've seen it can solve this problem by getting teachers and markers to judge the pupil work. And actually, it can help with the difficulty model. You can get teachers, markers, experts to judge the relative difficulty of questions before pupils sit them. And if you're interested in that second use, Ofqual, just about 18 months ago, did a big survey of about 3,000 different maths questions, and they got maths PhD students to judge them using comparative judgment, saying which is the more mathematically difficult question. So what you end up with is a lovely scale of about 2,500 maths GCSE questions ranked in order from least to most difficult. And that's on the Ofqual website. You can go in and look at that. Very interesting. So that's just a very quick survey of some of the things that I think help to make assessment effective in maths and science. The difficulty model, the one you're probably most used to, high reliability, easy to mark. The quality model, harder to mark, at least traditionally, but allows you to ask some of these more open